Hello there, beloved saints. Remember, if you want to know how much God loves you, read Song of Solomon. That's how passionate he is about his children. Now, this is concerning me, and please hear me out on this. A lot of people try to claim, now this is not a new claim, that a person must fall apart, feel bad, be convicted of sin, and grieve and mourn over how they've sinned against God, and feel really guilty for how they sinned before they can get saved. But that's not true. Actually, it's a little bit tricky and subtle. It's actually carnal pride mimicking humility. And this is why. That implies that there has to be something virtuous within us for us to be saved. Are you seeing that? See how sneaky Satan is? That is implying that there must be some virtue or goodness in a person's heart or change in them before Christ can save them. But there are no qualifiers. We are told, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. So what's necessary? You got to know you're lost, that you fall short of God's glory, and that you can't save yourself. And then you turn to the only one that can. You repent and trust in Christ. You don't trust in anything you do. You trust in what's already been done on Calvary. So this issue was addressed. Now, a lot of people twist what Charles Spurgeon has said. I believe the man was correct on the gospel based on what I've seen. I disagree with some of his stuff, but one of the best sermons I've ever heard or studied, I actually have this in print form, is called Warrant of Faith. Now, Brother Luke and I did a study on this line by line about a year and a half ago. I don't know if it's uploaded on his channel or not, but if so, please look at it. I may periodically pause this to scroll through the document, please hear me. See, there's a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. And we walk by faith, not by sight. And feelings are what? They're by sight. See, feelings come from thoughts. So our feelings follow our thought process. So what they're actually saying is, you've got to feel something in order to be saved. And that's not true. It's nonsense. Feelings have nothing at all to do with salvation. I know everybody wants conversion to be some big emotional experience, and it can be, and sometimes is, but we don't put our experience as the bar that other people have to meet. Okay, else they start questioning their own salvation when we're supposed to trust God's word and not our feelings. We walk by faith, not by sight. And these people want you to walk by sight. And that's not what we're supposed to do. I know we want to experience our faith, and but the thing is, feelings can lie, and but God's word does not. All right. So this implies there's got to be something virtuous in us. And I'm really glad that Spurgeon actually addressed this. Again, the sermon is called Warrant of Faith. Now, I'm going to read a section of it here. Let me move this camera out of the way real quick. See if I can move it. There we go. So I can open it back up. So I'm scrolling down, and it says, according to the text, a warrant for a man to believe is the commandment of God. This is the commandment, that you believe on his son, Jesus Christ. That's the commandment. That's salvation. Believe, pistios in the Greek, is to trust or rely upon, have confidence in. Okay? That's why I fight for the gospel. Most people are still trusting in what they do or how good they are, how bad they felt for their sins and their big emotional conversion. And I'm not mocking that. But that's not our foundation. That's sinking sand, because feelings change, but the word of God does not. The reason we have assurance is because it must be based on the promises of God, a God who cannot lie. Okay? So let's continue. Self-righteousness will always find a lodging somewhere or another. Are you hearing that? Self-righteousness will always find a lodging somewhere or another. Now, do you remember Satan comes as an angel of light and his ministers come as ministers of righteousness? He's always going to put some kind of you in there and give you, trick you into being prideful. This is actually pride masquerading as humility. It's true. I'm sorry, but please, please hear me. Drive it, my brethren, out of the ground of our confidence. Let the sinner see that he cannot rest on his good works. Then as foxes will have holes, the self-righteousness will find a refuge for itself in the warrant of our faith in Christ. It will. And it sneaks in here through our soul. All right? It's good once you're saved to have godly sorrow. The men in the second Corinthian letter had godly sorrow, which worketh repentance to salvation, not to be repented of, but sorrow of the world brings death. See, godly sorrow is for God's people, not the lost. Godly sorrow benefits us because it brings us to growing and turning away from behaviors that grieve the Holy Spirit, right? Benefits us. Sorrow of the world's pointless. Don't do anything. Godly sorrow does. But it's not godly sorrow and emotional feelings are not necessary to get saved. That's what I'm trying to show you here. Again, the reason we need to address this is because self-righteousness will find a hole to hide in. All right. And in this case, it's being hidden within the warrant of our faith. All right. So it says, you are not saved by what you do or anything in you, sorrow or otherwise, people, but what Christ did. But then you have no right to trust in Christ unless there's something good in you which shall entitle you to trust him. Do you see how it sneaks in? See, there's got to be something good in you. Virtuous heart of sorrow. It's sneaky, people. I'm telling you, please try to set your carnal thinking aside and hear what the Spirit says on this. All right. Let the sinner see. Let me see. All right, here we go. Now, this legal reasoning I oppose, and so do I. I believe such teaching to contain in it the essence of popish self-righteousness. The warrant for a sinner to believe in Christ is not in himself in any sense or in any manner, but in the fact that he is commanded there and then to believe on Jesus Christ. Okay, so what's the warrant of our faith? What is the one thing necessary for salvation? What is the one qualifier? The command of God to believe on his son, Jesus Christ. That's the only qualifier. That's all you need. Not in you, not sorrow, not feeling bad, not conviction of sin, not none of that, okay? People want to boast in that. I've heard them boast in it. And it sounds so right, but it's not. It's not. It's self-righteousness sounding like humility, okay? The godly sorrow in 2 Corinthians were for already saved brethren about dealing with a fornication in the church, all right? So, I agree with this so much. If you can read this sermon, please do. So, the warrant for a sinner to believe in Christ is not in himself in any sense or in any matter, but in the fact that he is commanded there and then to believe on Jesus Christ. Some preachers in the Puritanic times, whose shoe latchets I'm not worthy to unloose, erred much in this matter. I refer not merely to Alain and Baxter, who are far better preachers of the law than of the gospel, but I include men far sounder in the faith than they, such as Rogers and Denham, the author of The Sound Believer, and especially the American Thomas Hooker, who's written a book. Now, he did a book and describes this as sensible sinners. Okay, here's a qualifier these men are putting. These excellent men had a fear of preaching the gospel to any except those they styled sensible sinners, those that felt bad enough for their sin. Only those people should be saved. See, this is ridiculous. This is why Satan loves to sneak a qualifier into the gospel. The qualifier is the command of Jesus. That's it. The command to believe on Jesus. And it says, so basically they're,
okay, stop.
Basically, their whole thing was they wouldn't preach to anybody unless, quote, I possess such and such a degree of sensibility on the account of sin. Therefore, I have a right to trust in Christ. So when I say I'm sensible about sin and I feel bad enough for it, now I can trust in Christ. Do you see why this is dangerous? Now, I venture to affirm that such reasoning is seasoned with fatal error. Whosoever preaches in this fashion may preach much of the gospel, but the whole gospel of the free grace of God in its fullness he has yet to learn. In our own day, certain preachers assure us that a man must be regenerated before we can have him believe in Jesus. That's Calvin, and that's false, and he comes against that here. He said it takes away the gospel for sinners and offers a gospel for saints. Christ died to save the ungodly. Okay, these people are trying to make you qualify before you can even come to Christ. This is why it's wrong. They're trying to make you have some kind of virtue within yourself to say that an unsaved person has to have sorrow for sin and be convicted and get emotional before they can come to Christ. And that's not true. They just have to know they're lost and their only hope for salvation is the finished work of Jesus. That's it. Please stop adding qualifiers to it. It says, others say that the warrant for a sinner to believe in Jesus is his election. We're not going to argue election right here. And he says, first, negatively, here's my observation that any other way of preaching the gospel warrant is absurd. If I am to preach faith in Christ to a man who is regenerated, oh, he's arguing election there. We're not going to argue election. Let's see. Here we go. Secondly, to tell the sinner he has to believe on Christ because of some warrant in himself, do you feel bad enough? How do you feel about sin? He's unregenerate. How do you think he's going to feel about it? And even if he does feel guilty, that's called the conscience. You're not saved because you have a bigger conscience than somebody else. You just can't add it. It says that becomes legal, legalistic. It says, though this method is generally adopted by the higher school of Calvinists, if you got to feel bad for it, the sinner must have an awakened conscience before he can believe in Christ. Well, then if I trust Christ to save me because I have an awakened conscience, I say again, the most important part of the whole transaction is the alarm of my conscience, and the real trust hangs there. Hallelujah, man. I couldn't have said it better myself. Okay, then what are we trusting in, people? Are we trusting in Christ crucified and risen? Or are we trusting in the fact that we had a good conscience? Do you see the subtlety? Do you see the subtlety here? All right. And I love that he pointed it out. He said, I say again, the most important part of the whole transaction is the alarm of my conscience, and my real trust hangs there. If I lean on Christ alone, then this is legal indeed. Nay, even if the desires, even if the desires after Christ are to be my warrant for believing, if I am to believe in Jesus, not because he bids me, but because I feel some desire after him, you will again, with half an eye, perceive that the most important source of my comfort is my own desire. So we should always be looking within. Do I really desire Jesus? Do I really love God enough? Do I feel bad enough for my sin? Do you see how it's pointing to something in us? Something virtuous in us? Some qualifier? Can you please see how this is, but it seems so right to man. People will write me and argue with me and tell me, no, if you don't feel sorry for your sin, you're not saved. So you're telling me that that junkie's got to feel sorry that he's a heroin addict before he can come to the Lord, be saved, and then the Lord can start working on him? I didn't feel bad. I was strung out. I got sick when I stopped using. At that point, it wasn't even a moral issue. I was sick every day. I would vomit and shake and sweat. I couldn't function. So was I supposed to feel bad about that? See, there was no qualifier in me. I came to him because I needed a savior. And then he starts working on me. I am still a work. I'm still being worked on. If I'd have waited for something good in me before I went to him, do I feel bad enough for this? Does my addiction make me feel bad enough? It's in me. It's trying to find something good in me before I turn to Christ. And that's ridiculous. He died for the ungodly. We're wretched, lost sinners in a fallen state. We need the Lord, period. The reason and purpose for our faith is God commands it. That's all you need to know. He commands you to believe on his son, Jesus Christ, for eternal life. That's it. That's why we believe. That's the only qualifier we need. So he continues. I'm hoping you get the point here. Again, we're going to start questioning. If I do, then Christ can save me. And if I do not, then he cannot. Okay, there's the danger. It says, my desire overrides Christ and his grace. And he says, away with such legality. And it is. It's legalistic. Now you've got to qualify by feeling bad enough. Again, any other way of preaching than of bidding the sinner believe because God commands him to believe is boasting in their faith. See, there's so many subtle ways we boast, and it's all hidden, and it sounds so right, but it's not. Spiritually, you can see through it. Ask the Lord, he'll show you. For if my warrant to trust in Jesus be found in my experience, my loathings of sin, my hate for sin, or my longing and love for Christ, then all these good things of mine are illegitimate grounds of boasting. Okay, and what do I see? I felt bad. I had a conversion experience. I felt bad enough. I fell down. I can't tell you how many times people boast and think they're being humble. A lot of people are going to be mad at this, what I'm doing right now. That's all right. I don't want anybody thinking they got to feel this way or do this or have something in them before they come to Christ. You don't have to do anything. Believe because God commands it because it's true. All right? It says, all these good things of mine are a legitimate ground of boasting because Christ may save me, yet these were the wedding dress which fitted me to come to Christ. If these be indispensable prerequisites and conditions, then the man who has them may truly and justly say, Christ did save me, but I had the prerequisites and conditions first, and therefore let these share the praise. Yeah, Jesus saved me, but I hated my sin. I was willing to stop doing this. I loved God. It's still boasting in you. I am just so impressed with how he put this. He said it perfectly. See, my brethren, those who have a faith which rests upon their own experience, what are they as a rule? Mark them, and you will perceive much censorious bitterness in them, prompting them to set up their own experience as a standard for saintship. Oh, that is awesome. We do not put our experience as a standard for saintship, which may assuredly make us suspicious whether they were ever humbled in a gospel manner at all, so as to see that their own best feelings, their best repentances, their best experiences in themselves are nothing more or less than filthy rags in the sight of God. Oh man, what an amazing sermon. So I really hope you guys can hear what I'm saying. Feelings have nothing to do with salvation. There's nothing virtuous in you that you gotta have before you can come to Christ and be really saved. He already really saved us. You either believe him or you do not. All right, you guys, God bless you all.